Now we are going to understand what is the corrective action that can be taken to reduce the pressure drop. Now imagine a hardware. This is one column. And this is another column. And we connect both the columns at the bottom with the help of U connection. We are trying to understand the second limit, the answer to the second limitation, how to reduce the pressure drop. Now there is a sparger. I am showing schematically. I am going to show you designs of some typical spargers towards the end of the lecture, but there is a sparger. And there is no sparger here. There are two columns connected at the bottom with the help of U connection. At the top also they are connected. At the top also they are connected. The liquid is, the dispersion is right up to here. So since we are sparging only in the riser, obviously there is a gas holdup, and if we call gas holdup in the riser as epsilon g in the riser, epsilon g in the downcomer as drawn just now is zero. Correct, no? There is no sparging in the downcomer. The sparging is only riser. And obviously there is delta epsilon g. Since it is connected at the bottom, the pressure at points such as A is much lower than at point B because there is no gas. The density is equal to liquid density everywhere, whereas here it is the combined density. And therefore liquid circulation gets developed, which is upward. And obviously, therefore, it is called riser. The liquid takes a turn here, it goes down, and this part is called downcomer. And this is called riser. Is the construction understood? Yes? Yeah. And we know how to calculate the circulation velocity. Vc is equal to 2 times delta epsilon g, g into height of dispersion, square root of that. This is how we calculate. And we know that if this height was 10 meters, then the answer would have come 3.13 with 5% delta epsilon g. Right. If you keep 20%, it will become twice and we will get 6.26 meters per second. High circulation velocity. Now, because of some reason, there are bubbles in the downcomer as well. Please try to be attentive. There are bubbles in the downcomer until the stage there is a delta epsilon g, there will be circulation upward in the riser, downward in the downcomer. Correct? Though there are bubbles, the number of bubbles in the downcomer we keep in such a way that there is an existence of definitely delta epsilon g, and therefore there is a liquid circulation, right? And whatever those bubbles are there in the downcomer, if the order of magnitude of liquid velocity is higher than the bubble rise velocity, bubbles in the downcomer will also flow downwards. How many statements I have made? But it seems that all are understood. The first diagram I had drawn, there is a riser in which bubbles are there, and bubbles are only in the riser. The delta epsilon g is in such a way that holdup is in the riser, no holdup in the downcomer, and circulation pattern is very well established. Correct? The second stage of the hardware, which I have not of course explained in detail what that hardware will be, but we are imagining if there are bubbles in the downcomer, but the net effect is, suppose the number of bubbles here all put together are 10,000 and here the number of bubbles are 1,000, then also there is delta epsilon g, and delta epsilon g will result into circulation velocity. And if that circulation velocity, that was the last statement, if that circulation velocity, which is downward in the downward bubble, in the downcomer, all those bubbles will flow downwards if the circulation velocity is that intense, right? So the principal point to be understood is, and I'm making the statement, if we keep delta epsilon g in such a way that there is enough liquid circulation so that the circulation velocity is much higher than the bubble rise velocity, all those bubbles in the downcomer will really flow downwards, right? Now with this statement, have you generally understood this statement? Or once more? Just once more. Delta epsilon g gives this circulation velocity, this much understood? Right? Or this I should explain? No. So this is a circulation velocity. Now if we have some bubbles in the downcomer, delta epsilon g is going to reduce. Correct, no? Now there is some epsilon in the downcomer as well, and hold up in the riser minus hold up in the downcomer, which was zero at the beginning, there is some positive value now, and delta epsilon g reduces. And we can keep on increasing epsilon g in the downcomer, but always confirm that delta epsilon g, the resulting delta epsilon g at every stage results into circulation velocity which is much higher than bubble rise velocity. So whatever bubbles are there in the downcomer, the circulation is of course downwards. Bubbles introduced anywhere, they will flow downwards, they will flow upwards, and delta epsilon g will maintain the circulation velocity. Understood? Yes? What was the suggestion? Right. So you really wanted my next statement. Next statement. The next statement is like this. Suppose bubbles are existing everywhere in the column, right? And here you see to it that bubbles are there in, say, only 50% of the column height. The static pressure at B is clear liquid height into clear liquid density into G, and here whatever is the holdup multiplied by G multiplied by height of dispersion, that will be the pressure at B. Whereas pressure at A, where the entire column is filled with gas, the average density is less than the average density here, and pressure at A is less than pressure at B, PB minus PA prevails. As a result, there is a existence of this equation, and you get circulation rate, and you get epsilon G in the downcomer. Is it possible? Yes? So therefore, what I do, I put sparger in the downcomer. I start the riser sparger, establish the liquid circulation, confirm that liquid circulation is very high as compared to bubble rise velocity, and in the range of delta epsilon G that I am going to cover, still the bubbles in the downcomer are there going to flow downwards. At some stage, I will start the downcomer sparger, where the bubbling is in the part of the column. This part I think we must understand. If this is H1, this is the point B, and this is H2, and H1 plus H2 is HD. On this side, the pressure at point A is H1 plus H2 into epsilon GR into rho G epsilon LR into rho L into G. Whereas PB is equal to H1 epsilon G in the downcomer into rho G into G plus H2, where gas is not there, into epsilon GD into rho G. Anyway, it is not there. So, into rho L into G. So, in this portion, there is a gas liquid dispersion H1. So, it is a combination of the density will be overall density H1 epsilon GD rho G plus epsilon LD into rho L into G. Whereas whenever we consider this portion, epsilon GR is, this is epsilon, we should always write epsilon GD is equal to 0. So there is no epsilon G. Therefore, in the second part of the equation, we have written epsilon GD only for this part. The bubbles are present only in the part of the column, whereas there is a clean column above that, and the overall pressure at point B as a result of these two sections, where one is only liquid and one is gas and liquid, always the pressure at point B is more than pressure at point A. As a result, we get liquid circulation, which is more than. So how do we operate? We start the riser sparger, establish the liquid circulation. Perhaps it is 3.13 meter per second, right? 3.13 meter per second. Then we introduce gas through downcomer sparger, and delta epsilon d, which was 0.05, comes down to 0.04. So instead of 3.13, with 0.04, what is the value? (2.8 meters per second), correct? But bubble rise velocities, I have told you, these are of the order of 0.1 meter per second, 0.2 meter per second, maximum 0.5 meter per second. So this circulation velocity of 2.8 meter per second, all the bubbles introduced in the downcomer will also flow downwards. Instead of 0.04, make it 0.02. Because you are increasing gas holdup in the downcomer, and delta epsilon g arising out of this is just 2. So 1.8 will become 0.9 meter per second. Still it is higher than bubble rise velocity. So all the bubbles will flow downwards. So you start the riser sparger, establish the liquid circulation, and you keep on sparging the gas in the downcomer in such a way that delta epsilon g exists, the pressure driving force exists, and the circulation velocity is higher than bubble rise velocity, so that bubbles flow downwards. When the circulation is established, you stop now the riser sparger. This entire column is filled with gas. This part of the column is filled with gas. Again, we maintain positive PB minus PA. There is a liquid circulation, so that though we are sparging here, the bubbles are flowing downwards and bubbles are flowing upwards. This is called external loop airlift reactor. Have you understood the principle? Yes? Or once more? Yeah.
Will there not be the recirculation of the bubbles? Because at the top point there will be less pressure.
Yeah. So there is a gas liquid dispersion. So whether gas liquid dispersion will enter this pipe, and there is a recirculation of this. That possibility you are considering? Is that the question? Right. So this particular gas disengagement zone is designed in such a way that whatever may be the liquid circulation velocity here, the local velocity in the expanded region is always less than bubble rise velocity. And that is called the disengagement zone. The definition of disengagement zone is bubbles will disengage only when the downward liquid velocity is less than the bubble rise velocity. So we select the cross section in that region in such a way that in the entire range of liquid circulation, the local liquid velocity is less than bubble rise velocity. So both are disengagement zones. Because of this disengagement, anyway, the gas holdup here is small. And if at all gas goes to the other side, there is a disengagement zone on the other side, and gas gets disengaged. There are more provisions made in order to reduce the problem. A baffle is made, and baffle is kept like this, so that the bubbles going in this manner, the number of bubbles entering that side, that number decreases, and anyway there is a disengagement zone on the other side. So that problem is eliminated by providing proper disengagement zones. What is the overall effect? You are passing gas at 50% height, and you are getting the benefit of dispersion, which is half here and full here. So now pressure drop is 50% of the overall pressure drop, and you are getting dispersion. This is a small benefit. The real benefit is there is one such external loop airlift reactor in England, the height of which is 500 meters, half a kilometer. Can you imagine half a kilometer? Imagine a column with a height of half a kilometer. Both riser and downcomer, both are half a kilometer. So half a kilometer, 500 meters, if it is only water where density is known, with 500 meters, what is the static pressure at the bottom? Order of magnitude? 500 meters? How much? 10 density is 1000. Yes. 10 to the power 6. So typically every 10 meters is 1 atmosphere, 500 meters is 50 atmospheres. Right? So now you need to compress gas at 50 atmospheres so that you can introduce at the bottom. And that airlift reactor is in such a way, the sparger is at half the location, and now we need to introduce gas at a pressure of only 25, not 50. And pressure drop is reduced from 50 atmosphere to 25 atmosphere. You introduce gas at 25 atmosphere and you know solubility is equal to partial pressure into Henry's coefficient. Total pressure is increasing proportional to hydrostatic head. Gas which is introduced at 25 atmosphere goes through the region of 30, 35, 40, 50 atmosphere where solubility is high. And then continuously, of course, the pressure will reduce. So the gas is introduced at a location where the pressure drop is half the pressure drop, and we get the benefit of high pressure, high solubility, and in this manner, we reduce the intensity of the second limitation of reduction in pressure drop with the design of external loop airlift reactor. Understood? Yes? No. If you have any questions, I'll be very happy to explain. Now I will show you some slides. So this is what I have shown. So let us not worry, go to the next one. Next one, you can stand. Next. So this is the bubble column which is shown, the figures which are familiar to you. There is a sparger at the bottom. So now, so this bubble column is familiar with you, to you. Next slide. I had drawn co-current and counter-current, the liquid phase, the gas phase, the sparger at the bottom in the form of perforated plate. Next. Then there are different types of spargers. One is called porous and another is perforated, and I'm going to show you different sparger designs. Next one. So the C plate, this what is that I'm explaining. A plate with perforations is called plate type sparger. And in sectionalized bubble column, where we converted a back mix reactor into complete plug flow reactor, the design is like this. What is not shown here is the downcomer, provision for downcomer. This is a typical sparger for a classical bubble column. Next slide. This is called spider sparger. There is a main header, and then these are side pipes, and holes are drilled on the pipes. So this is called a spider type of sparger. The next one, this is the ring sparger, and the number of rings we provide. In all the cases, the number of holes and diameter of hole we select in such a way that the no whip condition is satisfied all the time. Next. This is called radial sparger. The gas comes from the outside, and then the pipes go centrally inward. Here in this case, by the way, I have personally used all these spargers. I have designed more than 1,000 reactors up till now. Right. My only suggestion to all of you ask me any number of questions. I want to deliver all my knowledge, all my experience to you. 1,000, I'm telling you, because I'm able to count up to 1,000. I can say thousands. So all those, you can say, challenges that I must have faced, not that all the time there were successes, there were failures. So you should be asking me large number of questions. If something is not understood, quickly raise your hand. This point I have not understood. Correct, no? And let us consider our objective of this class is all of us understand multiphase reactor design and how to get optimum design so that the cost is minimum and the net equipment is most attractive as compared to if it was designed anywhere in the world. So we want to reach that stage. But if you don't understand, say, today's 3 sentences and the first lecture's 5 sentences, going ahead and appreciating the optimization is very difficult. And the question, there is nothing like a big question, original question, high quality question, low quality question. All questions are questions, right now. And good part is, whatever question you have in mind, typically many others have the same question. So my suggestion to you is, I am here for you and for imparting all the experience to you. All. And you try to extract it from me. Right? Normally what teachers say, that if I have not understood your question, I will prepare and come next time. In my case of multiphase reactor design, these occasions will be very few. The point I'm trying to communicate again and again, you extract. So you imagine we have taken only 3 hours or 3.5 hours. We have yet to go. And what we are imagining now, I may extend this, not Thursdays, the Thursdays number I cannot increase, but I can engage for 30 minutes more. We'll spend unlimited time together, right? And then it'll happen. Okay. So these are, what really happens, show the previous one. And the previous. It is here. Imagine this sparger. I'm holding myself to explain more things. If you are not understood, I should not enter into a region where few more things are not understood. So I'm keeping something with me, but let me try one more, right? I want to tell you many, many more things. I should not reserve something with me. Imagine gas is entering from here, right? Some gas goes away, and the volumetric flow rate here is less than the volumetric flow rate. And the Bernoulli's equation says that because of lower velocity, subsequently there will be pressure rise, and pressure at this point is much more than the pressure at that point. And the sparging, the gas sparging rate at this end is much higher than the sparging rate. So this creates non-uniformity. So if you can reduce this length, then uniformity will increase, and therefore the design is like this. So the sparger goes to here, there will be of course non-uniformity, but we have reduced by half. So there is a big ring around the column, a very big ring, provides the gas at the same pressure so that we try to get the uniformity. Right? So next, which I am using maximum, this is called wheel type sparger. You imagine a cylinder at the center, and then the six pipes are emerging. A vessel at the center, six pipes are emerging. If six are not enough, you make another layer and have more number of pipes. You can provide 5, 10, 15, 6, 16, 20, any number depending upon number of hole requirement. I found this design to be optimum. Then this is homogeneous regime shown here. You can see all the bubbles are of the same size, and here there is a heterogeneity. So homogeneous and heterogeneous is shown. The hold-up profile which I had drawn arising out of the pressure profile, pressure is minimum here, therefore circulation pattern upward in the center. I'm showing this again. This is the graph which I showed you. I had drawn only one. But if the interfacial, the surface tension is less, or in the there is a presence of electrolytes in the column, the bubble formed at the sparger itself is of smaller size. So for a given superficial velocity, we get more number of bubbles, and therefore for low surface tension liquids at this gas velocity, high surface tension liquid has a less hold up and more hold up. But you get a maxima, the maxima is at higher, but eventually all of them collapse at point E, where the heterogeneous regime is completely established. So that was when pressure of the column is increased, the rate of coalescence decreases at high pressure, and the rate of breakup remains the same. So whenever the columns are under pressure, the average bubble size is less. Therefore, as the pressure increases, again you get the similar behavior, the holdup increases at any point. But you always have homogeneous regime, the transition regime, and heterogeneous regime. The several lines are only because of the average bubble as generated near the sparger, or the average bubble because of the net effect of coalescence and dispersion. Yeah. I like this. Let it happen many more times. This one or previous one, or both are same? After this? Yeah. Yeah. So this arrow you can see, this arrow, at the end of the arrow what is shown, increase in pressure or non-coalescing behavior of gas liquid system, right? We operate the column at 1 atmosphere. There are gases like hydrogen where the solubility is very low, and if you want to increase the solubility, we operate such columns at high pressure, maybe 20 atmospheres, 50 atmospheres. So as the pressure increases, the gas pressure, the rate of coalescence of bubbles, that decreases, and rate of breakup of bubbles, that remains the same. So whatever is gas parched at the bottom, at higher pressures, the average bubble size is smaller as compared to the sizes at low pressures. Non-coalescing nature means you add something in such a way that coalescence is prevented, like electrolyte. So electrolyte forms a stabilizing layer at the interface. You can also add surface active agent that also prevents the coalescence. So there are some coalescence preventing agents. If we normally we should not add anything deliberately, because that adds to the impurity in the overall product. But it is likely that the raw material itself has surface active agent or a non-coalescing behavior in some manner. So those agents and high pressure operation, the average bubble size is less. So when average bubble size is less, for same volumetric flow rate, the number of bubbles are more. And smaller bubbles, they also rise at a slower rate than the larger bubbles, or they stay for more time inside the column. Therefore, with smaller bubbles at the same superficial gas velocity, we have higher holdup. So as the pressure increases, we get smaller and smaller holdup. They stay in the column for more time, and therefore holdup increases, right? And smaller bubbles, they retain homogeneity for longer time. The possibility of disturbance, which is mainly because of the lift, which I explained. Actually, the lift force keeps some clean liquid in the vicinity of the wall. They drive away bubbles from the wall. That is, we can call it as a wall effect. As a result, whenever there is clean liquid near the wall, it introduces delta epsilon G directly, right? And therefore, the beginning of heterogeneous regime happens. So when the bubbles are small, the lift is also small, and the transition to heterogeneity, that delays. And you can see that which one? Now I wanted to show the maximum. Thank you. Show the next one. The difficulty was with the next one. Yeah. So you can see the transition, the first transition has also delayed. The second transition is also homogeneous to transition, and transition to heterogeneity gets delayed because of the smaller bubbles. The smaller bubbles have less of lift, and therefore delta epsilon G introduction happens at higher holdup, and therefore it is delayed. Does it answer your question?
Yes.
Yeah. Any other question? Right. So this is a sectionalized bubble column, where sectionalization is in the form of radial baffles. Here the radial baffles are in the form of a cone. These are conical baffles. And we try to prevent such baffles are used whenever there is a possibility of solid phase. In such a horizontal plate, the solids get accumulated, and here in a counter current flow, they flow nicely downwards. And this is the last slide, which was a diagram which I was showing. There is an accumulation of gas here. This is the downcomer, this is the downcomer, accumulation of gas. And we have several bubble columns in series, several back mix reactors in series, and complete back mixing is converted into plug flow. Have you understood this picture? Yeah. And this is the riser and downcomer. The downcomer is here, this is the U-bend, this is the sparger, and this is external loop airlift reactor. This also I have used in variety of locations. In the large number of oxidations and hydrogenations, manufacture of hydrogen peroxide, 100 tons per day hydrogen peroxide. So this is the, so the here the expanded portion, one who asked me the possibility of gas going on the other side, the, yeah, now this is one tank, a big tank, one big tank, and then the column plan view you can see in the form of circles. The point being communicated is the disengagement area is so high that the gas doesn't come to the downcomer. The gas doesn't come means sporadically few bubbles here and there they will come, that's okay. But there is net, there is no net high flux of gas from riser to downcomer. Sufficient care is taken in that manner. Next, like external loop, there is internal loop also, there is a column inside the column rather than column side by side, right. So gas is sparged here, it goes up, then it comes down in the annular region. So it is something similar to bubble column where there is more gas in the central region and less gas in the but now here there is a physical partition and bubble column is converted into internal loop airlift reactor. So up to this I have taught you, and if there is any additional question for today, okay, then we'll continue next Thursday.